Penguin Random House Audio presents Blonde Roots by Bernardine Evaristo. Read for you by Sandra James Young.
Remembering the 10 to 12 million Africans taken to Europe and the Americas as slaves and their descendants. 1444 to 1888.
And this quotation from the work of Friedrich Nietzsche.
All things are subject to interpretation. Whichever interpretation prevails at a given time is a function of power and not truth. Book One. O Lord, take me home. So while my boss, Bwana, and his family are out clinking rum and coke glasses and shaking their wobbly backsides at fancy parties down the road, I've been assigned duties in his office to sort through his ledgers. I used to hope that the celebration of Voodoo Mass would be the one day off in the year for us slaves, but oh no, it's business as usual. Outside the window, the palm trees which line the avenues are decorated with gold and silver streamers. They are tall, sleek, snooty, with the deportment of those who grow up balancing the precious milk of coconuts on their heads. And dangling from their glossy green fronds are flickering oil lamps sitting in red-painted cassava gourds. The cobblestone pavement has been swept smooth of yesterday's sandstorm, and the hawkers selling takeaways have been sent packing. Frogs and crickets provide a drunken nighttime chorus, while camel-drawn carriages deliver stushed party guests to our neighbouring compounds. The men wear flamboyant caftans, and their glamorously fat women try to outdo each other with peacock print headscarves tied up into the most extravagant girly bows. All the houses are freshly whitewashed, with stained glass windows depicting the gods. Oshan, Shangira, Yemunja. Stone sphinxes guard porches, and stationed by doorways are torch lamps on tall marble plinths. Their flames are slippery blue fingers grasping out at the sticky nighttime air. From the upper rooms of the houses blast the hectic electronic beats of the young, and from downstairs comes the mellow music of the marimba, amid the laughter and bantering of people who have every reason to celebrate this season of goodwill, because they are free men and free women in the heart of the most expensive piece of real estate in the known world, Mayfair. Chief Kaga Konata Katamba I is the Bwana in question. He made his fortune in the import-export game, the notorious transatlantic slave run, before settling down to life in polite society as an absentee sugar baron, part-time husband, freelance father, retired decent human being, and, it goes without saying, sacked soul. My boss is also a full-time anti-abolitionist, publishing his pro-slavery rants in his mouthpiece, The Flame, a pamphlet distributed far and wide as a freebie. In spite of myself, I'd just begun to flick through the latest god-awful issue, feeling my stomach constrict and my throat tighten, when a hand shoved a folded note through the open office window and vanished before I could see who it was attached to. I opened the note, read the magic words, and felt my head suddenly drowning. Waves crashed and thundered inside my skull. I let out the most almighty silent howl. Then I passed out. How long for, I've no idea, maybe a few minutes, but when I came to, I was slumped in my seat, my head dropped forward, the note still in my hand. I read it again through a film of water. It was real and it was true. I was being given the chance to escape. Oh Lord. After so many years on the waiting list, the thing I most desired was in the palm of my hand, yet it was all too quick. I sat there frozen. A thousand what-ifs ran through my mind. In returning my life to its rightful owner, me, I would also be putting my life at stake, If I wasn't careful or lucky, I'd end up at the local whipping post or chopping block. Then my survival instincts kicked in. My head cleared. I was back again. I ripped the note to shreds. I stood up and looked at the wooden mask of Bwana's face on the wall, and I gave it the right royal one-finger salute. The note told me that the Underground Railroad was operating again after service had been suspended owing to derailment. It was often the case when energy couldn't be filched from the city's power station or the train broke down due to the overload of escaping slaves wanting to catch a safe ride out of the city to begin the long journey back to the motherland. I hoped I could trust the message, because the resistance was often infiltrated by sleepers who eventually went operational to betray whole rebel cells. Deep down, I knew that the slave traders were never going to give up their cash cow. It was, after all, one of the most lucrative international businesses ever, involving the large-scale transport of whites shipped in our millions from the continent of Europa to the West Japanese islands, so called because when the great explorer and adventurer Chinua Chikwemeka was trying to find a new route to Asia, he mistook those islands for the legendary Isles of Japan, and the name stuck. So, here I am, in the United Kingdom of Great Ambossa, UK or GA for short, which is part of the continent of Africa. The mainland lies just over the Ambossan Channel. It's also known as the Sunny Continent, of course, on account of it being so flaming hot here. Great Ambossa is actually a very small island with a growing population to feed, and so it stretches its greedy little fingers all over the globe, stealing countries and stealing people. Me included, I'm one of the stolen ones. That's why I'm here. The note gave me only 1 hour to get to the disused Paddingtoe station and directions on how to find the manhole hidden behind some bushes through which I could slip down into the subway. There, I would be met by a member of the resistance who would lead me through its dank subterranean tunnels. That was the promise, anyway. And if it wasn't the practice, I'd be done for. Slavery had taught me that promises never came with a money-back guarantee, and if you complained to customer services, they'd report you to management, and then you'd really get it in the neck. But I'm a firm believer in hope. I am still alive, after all. The city of Lunderloh's tube trains had officially stopped burrowing many years ago when the tunnels started collapsing under the weight of the buildings above them. The city returned to the slower but more reliable modes of transport. Carriages, horses, carts, camels, elephants, stagecoaches, and for the really nutty fitness fanatics, velocipedes. The only vehicle we slaves owned was called Shank's Pony. But here's the thing. At some point, a bright spark in the resistance had a brainwave, and the disused subway was put to use, enabling many to make their way out of the heavily guarded city of Lunderloh as far as the docks, where they began the long, hazardous trip back to Europa. For the first time since I had been taken away, I could seriously consider that I might be returning home. Was it possible? I still had such vivid memories of my parents, my three sisters, our little flint cottage on the estate, and my beloved cocker spaniel, Rory. My family were probably all dead now, if they had survived the raids by the Borderlander men, who had been my first captors. The Ambossans called us tribes, but we were many nations, each with our own language and funny old customs, like the Borderlanders whose men wore tartan skirts with no knickers underneath. The Ambossans also called Europa the Grey Continent on account of the skies always being overcast. But oh, how I longed for those cloudy grey skies. How I longed for the incessant drizzle and harsh wind slapping my ears. How I longed for my snug winter woolies and sturdy wooden clogs. How I longed for Mam's warm dripping sandwiches and thick pumpkin broth. How I longed for the fire crackling in the hearth and our family sing-song around it. How I longed for the far northern district from whence I was taken. How I longed for England. How I longed for home. I am proud to declare that I come from a long line of cabbage farmers. My people were honest peasants who worked the land and never turned to theft, even when it snowed in summer or rained all winter, so that the crops miscarried in their pods and turned to mulch. We weren't landowners, oh no, we were serfs, the bottom link in the agricultural food chain. Although no actual chains clinked on the ground when we walked around, nor were we property exactly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.